Braxton Brady, and I have the privilege and honor of being the head of school here at ECS. On behalf of the faculty and staff of ECS, we welcome you tonight. I tell people all the time, I now have my dream job. I mean that with all my heart. And I'm 24 days on the job, and I'm not sure that it's going to get any better than what we're about to do tonight. It is my dream job because of two things: the mission statement of the school and the people that are here. And there is no doubt that Mr. Brink exemplifies both of those better than anybody I know. We've only had one disagreement. He walked into my office and sat me down. As you know, since he's been here for quite some time, I must admit I was a little intimidated. And he sat down and he said, "I need you to do me a favor." And of course I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "I need you to call me Mark." And I said, "No, sir." And he knows that, and we laugh about that every single day, and I will not do that. Ever. One, because of the man he is, and two, because of the man I believe and know him to be. So I am so excited for this night. Would you please join me in prayer as we start? Father, I am humbled to be in a room full of the past, the present, and future students of ECS. Father, there's not a day that goes by that I don't walk on this campus and just smile, because your hand is on the school, and that we are free to proclaim your name on a daily basis. Father, thank you for Mr. Brink, for his life, for his humility, for his modeling of Philippians chapter 2, 3 through 5, of doing nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility counting others more than himself. Father, it is truly a blessing to be in the role that I'm in. Father, I pray that ECS will always be a school that seeks to glorify you in all that we say, in all that we do. We give this night over to you. May you be glorified. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. About 5 days into the job, I asked Coach Rulos, Coach Rulos made a comment to me. He goes, "You know what, you're a lot like a guy that I know pretty well." And I was like, "Well, this could be good and scary all at the same time." And he said, "You need to meet this man." And it was actually on my notes, one of the first days of the job, is that I wanted to meet Mickey Bowden. And so Coach Rulos set that up, and we spent almost 2 hours talking about the history of the school. It's some of the best 2 hours that I've ever spent in my life. And I met, just out of those 2 hours, I would consider him a friend. One, because of his passion for the school. And man, if you want to know some stories about this place, that is the man to go to. And so I want to introduce Mr. Mickey Bowden to you.
Began 1973. We were in our second year of developing a high school. It was our second year on this campus. Our highest grade was the 10th grade. Those 25 sophomores would become our first graduating class. We were several weeks into the school year, still looking for a full-time Bible teacher. Our Bible classes were being taught by some local pastors who were substituting. And Mark Brink was just completing his duty as a captain in the United States Army, and he applied for the position. Was well received, and of course we offered him the position, and he agreed to accept it, but only for 1 year. Now he's in his 46th year. And it's amazing to me to think that every student who has earned an ECS diploma since its inception, and that's approximately 4,700 students, every one of those students has been influenced, has been mentored, has been shepherded, and has been loved by Mr. Brink. Having personally experienced God's love, Mark has endeavored to have all his students experience God's love and respond to God's love and mercy. He's truly a Holy Spirit enabled and empowered and gifted teacher. He has demonstrated for his students, for his colleagues, for his students' parents, how to live as a disciple of Christ. I had the privilege of working with Mark for 19 years, from 73 to 92, and I've had the opportunity to observe his ministry in the 27 years since then. I've seen his heart for the Lord, and I've seen his influence as a husband, as a father, as a friend, as a leader in his church. Now, although I know that Mr. Brink is honored by this occasion, but he would not want this occasion to focus on him. It's just not his spirit. I'm sure that he would want his Lord and his Savior, and all the honor and all the praise go to God. He's never sought personal honor or the praise of men, and I've always known him to be reluctant to receive any recognition. But I think it's fitting that this room that we're in, this chapel auditorium, to henceforth be known as the Mark Brink Auditorium. Because this is the place where ECS comes to worship. And that's what Mark's experience in ministry at ECS has been about. It's been about his worship of his Lord. And he has endeavored to instill in all his students that spirit of worshiping God with their heart, with their mind, and with their actions. Jesus referred to the Apostle Peter as the rock upon which he would build his church. In my humble opinion, Mark Brink has been a rock upon which the mission of ECS has been built. God has used Mark in all of our lives to challenge and to teach us to seek Christ first and his kingdom above all else. I wonder if you would just stand and join with me. Just repeat after me. Mark Brink.
Mark Brink.
Well done.
Well done.
Faithful servant.
Faithful servant.
Mark's granddaughters, Noelle and Susanna, are going to come and lead us in the doxology.
Oh, the depth of the riches and the wisdom.
a tough act to follow. Thank you, girls. I suppose I stand here on behalf of all the parents of those 4,700 children that have gone through ECS. Many of you are parents of those children that have been taught by Mark. I remember Marcia and I in our early years at River Oaks were praying that if we were blessed with children, they would have the opportunity to be taught by Mark Brink. And in God's good providence, all four of our children were able to sit under his teaching. Now we're praying that our grandchildren, Mark, sit under your teaching. And they're close, only 10 or 15 years away. The year is 2064. Students at ECS are busily preparing for the 100th anniversary of the school's founding. Another state championship in football has just been won. John Rulofs has just announced that he's considering retirement. The editors of the yearbook are reviewing the early years of ECS history, and they keep finding references, pictures that refer to a certain Mark Brink. "What's a Mark Brink?" one says to another. "I don't know," comes the reply, "but we must find out. Why don't we check Wikipedia?" So they go to Wikipedia, who knows everything, and they find their answer. Quote, "A Mark Brink is a rare and remarkable individual who blends northern roots with southern fruits. Known for the pursuit of truth and is especially devoted to roaming through Romans. The term is descriptive of anyone who aspires to so love God and his neighbor that he is a warrior in prayer, a fountain of kindness, a reservoir of wisdom, and a portrait of humble faithfulness." See footnote. It is not clear that an actual Mark Brink ever existed. The legend of such an individual exceeds any realistic expectation that any one person could have exhibited all the qualities attributed to him. It is best to conclude that over time, the finest qualities of Christian grace and personal character all became part of what it meant to be a Mark Brink. I met Mark and Sandy Brink 38 years ago when we were much younger. We worshiped and worked and walked together ever since. And Mark has been to me a wise counselor, a frequent encourager, a godly role model, a faithful servant leader in the life of our church. He would reflect Bunyan's valiant for truth in Pilgrim's Progress. But what I treasure most about Mark is what I find most grievous in our culture. Mark exhibits a trait that is all too rare in our day. A life lived in the fear of God. Now, it's not that Mark is frightened by the presence of the Lord. He delights to know that God is near. But he realizes that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Mark demonstrates a life lived coram Deo, before the face of God. He is not shaped by the winds of culture, the pursuit of comfort, or the goal of being politically correct. Because he fears God, Mark cherishes God's word, applies God's truth to his own heart, and then seeks to communicate that truth in whatever classroom is provided to him, whether at home, at church, or at school. In a world described as a place where there is no fear of God before their eyes, Mark Brink has been enabled to be a remarkable exception. He has known the light of the gospel and has shined his light faithfully to many who have graced his classrooms. They in turn have taken the light of Christ to the four corners of the earth. Now, I'm sure Mark is quite uncomfortable tonight with the words that will be spoken about him. He would say, "I am but a jar of clay in whom the Savior dwells." And he would want us to rejoice in the Savior who came to this earth to make his blessings flow far as the curse is found. He would invite others, with the words of Psalm 34, "Come, my children, listen to me, and I will teach you the fear of the Lord." I count myself among those privileged to have been taught by Mark Brink, and on behalf of all who share that testimony, I would say we are most thankful to God for your impact, Mark, on our lives and the lives of future generations of God-loving and God-fearing disciples of Christ. Sole Deo Gloria. And now we will hear from Mark's son, Noah.
It's only been a few years that ECS has been naming spaces after employees. Never buildings, just spaces within them. A worldview center, a hospitality room, a court, an auditorium. In some ways, I feel that it's fitting for a school which historically has been far more interested on what's going on here than bells and whistles and externals. I used to joke even with friends that maybe a tagline of ECS should be, "Stucco buildings, good people." In a similar way, Dad, your tenure here at ECS has been characterized far more by substance than show. There have been so many times where I wished that my dad's voice would have been louder, where he would have asserted himself, his influence, in seasons of need. Yet I think we all know what has probably most endeared ourselves to my dad and to his coworkers and students is his steadiness, his faithfulness, his wisdom, and his compassion. For the Brinks, the rhythm of our lives has been dictated to by ECS. It's what my brothers and my mom most know. So, of course, many of my childhood memories are associated with this school. Riding the bus to school with my dad as the driver. I don't know if you know that he was a bus driver at one point. Of course, going to lots of games and lots of plays and concerts. Even most of my childhood heroes were high school students here at ECS that I routinely watched. And of course, there were challenges to being the son of a person who typically was only described with use of hyperbole. And then to one day sit in these classes as a student, myself as a firsthand witness of my dad's craft, a side of him I had never seen. I just grew up hearing about my dad, the teacher. Of course, I took great joy in laughing at things that I knew were jokes, but my classmates didn't see as jokes. So I, too, am one of the thousands of students who have been taught Romans, Chantry, Trobisch, Schaefer, a Christ-centered, biblically directed education, which challenges students to know the Lord Jesus Christ. So each year, students enter my dad's class. As my dad's grown older, the students have grown younger. They come in with a sense of awe and mystique. It's Mr. Brink. They don't quite know what to do with my dad, especially, as I mentioned, with his jokes. But even though they don't fully know what's going on, they know, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that they're part of something special. As an educator and a father myself, Psalm 127 has become one of my favorites. It has often recentered me as an educator and as a father. The psalmist starts out saying, "Unless the Lord builds this house, those who build it labor in vain." And he continues, "Children are a heritage from the Lord. The fruit of the womb a reward. Like arrows in the hand of a warrior are children of one's youth. Blessed is the man who fills his quiver with them. He shall not be put to shame when they contend with the enemies in the gates." Dad, you have a full quiver. But the reason for having a quiver full of arrows isn't just to boast over the amount that you have. But you prepare and you sharpen them for the day they are to be sent out to contend with the enemies in the gates. Three of these arrows your sons have been sharpened, that they are a heritage from the Lord. And that heritage has been passed on even to your 9 grandchildren. They too are arrows to one day be sent out. And thousands of other arrows have been sharpened in my dad's classroom. And I know that some of my dad's greatest joys have been reconnecting with these arrows after they have returned from being sent out. My dad has had many students, but in many ways I feel like I am the most blessed of them all. Yes, I sat in my dad's class decades ago. I'm also his son, and I also got to be his co-worker for 10 years. To be my dad's son, and yet to be treated as a peer, to be on his plane, I don't have the mental categories to make sense of that. And even more so, that my dad would be willing to be taught by his son. It speaks to a level of humility that few people possess. But I'm not the only one. The coworkers that I worked with for several years, they too felt like they were treated as peers by my dad, even though we know we're not. Each teacher has tremendous emotional investment in his students. That's why we do what we do. And with that emotional investment comes great joy and great sadness. My mom has walked through these and carried these same emotions with my dad. She has supported my dad's work through many lean years. Because my dad's calling in this place has been unmistakable, Mom, you also have had a lot of skin in this place. And Dad's 46 years here has required a great deal of sacrifice and support on your part. I remember when this chapel was being built. I remember going with my dad as he was hoping to get his hands on some of the trees so we could cut it up for firewood. This building was built because ECS needed a functional space for worship, for celebration, for the community to come together as one community. How can a school be a community if it's never together in one space? The stadium on Friday night is one of those spaces. But this specific one, this auditorium, and what has gone on in all of these years in this space for decades, I would say most defines the ethos and mission of this school. And so it's fitting that my dad's name is attached to this auditorium. For in this auditorium, this school community is most often reminded as a community of the gospel. The gospel, the Evangelium, the evangel, evangelical Christian school, gospel Christian school. So it's fitting to have this space named after my dad, who has been unswerving in reminding us all, not just his faithful seniors, but his co-workers as well, of this gospel. Of course, Dad, you've taught us all enough about the gospel that we realize the theological problem associated with saying that any one man deserves an honor like this. May it never be that we forget the lessons you've taught. But I will say, even though we cannot say that anyone deserves something like that, we are very proud of you. So it's a joy to celebrate you with you.
I have lost 4 straight nights of sleep thinking about this. This is very emotional for all of us, so if I lose it halfway through and start sobbing like a little girl, I'm sorry. I will probably not make eye contact with you too much, Mr. Brink. But if the world looked at what we're doing here today, they would say, you Christian idiots. Don't you know? You name a building after someone who gives a bunch of money, or someone who brings a bunch of people to your school. I mean, there's a limited amount of structures that you can dedicate, so save it for the big-time donors. As Christians, we would say no, may it never be. When we step back and recognize what Mr. Mark Brink has given to this place, we realize we can't repay you. There's no way. There aren't enough spots on this campus to give back for your time, sweat, work, prayers, and wisdom. There's a debt to you that we owe, and to be honest, naming this auditorium really just doesn't cut it. But of course, that reminds me of the gospel. In just a small way, a debt we can't repay. The gospel, your favorite subject. What are your words? I can't, he can. Tim Keller says, the gospel is this: we are more sinful and flawed in ourselves than we ever dared believe. Yet at the very same time, we are more loved and accepted in Jesus Christ than we ever dared hope. As a tennis coach, I run into students from other schools, and year after year, it has struck me that the personalities of those students don't change that much. An MUS student from 20 years ago is very similar to a MUS student today. A Lausanne student from 20 years ago is very similar to a Lausanne student today. Now I'm stereotyping, and there's definitely diversity. But I asked my former principal about it, and he said the culture of a school is shaped by the mission statement and by the pillars in the community of that institution. It may be a headmaster that's been there a long time. It could be an influential Bible teacher. In the Christian community, we talk about believers being a body. Mr. Brink, you are the heart and mind of BCS. I am probably the bladder. Your DNA runs through the veins of BCS. Honestly, what have you done that was so great? You've pointed us to another. Behind your back, we have a nickname for you, and it is Teflon Mark. Because nothing seems to stick to you. You are always pointing us to Scripture. You are always directing us to Christ. When I think of you, I think of a signpost. The rest of the world says, look at me, look at me. From our politicians on down the ladder, we are taking selfies and pointing to ourselves. You have stood in the gap and said, no, this life is not all about me. It is about Christ. As a good father, you gave us what we needed, not what we wanted. As a good teacher, you directed us to the solution, not just one more set of problems. As you and I talk about two atheists on occasion, they think they've got us all figured out. Oh, they say, we know why you're Christians. It's fire insurance. You don't want to go to hell. Or maybe it's the golden ticket. You want to get to heaven. This week in discipleship groups, we talked about running the race and how the Christian walk is like running a race. I'm reminded of Clay Enoch's wonderful statue on the wall of the Legacy Center, and all these athletes are pushing through the finish line, only we can't see what's on the other side of the tape. In fact, the Christian Marathon doesn't look like any track meet we've ever had at ECS. It looks like the Special Olympics. Why? Philippians 3, 13 and 14. But one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. In the Special Olympics, those athletes don't care so much about the medals or recognition. They strive and struggle for the tape because a family member lies behind the finish line ready to embrace them. That's what we as Christians yearn for, unity with Christ. We know you don't want to be here today. John Ruloff remarked yesterday how uncomfortable you were feeling. We're going to sleep after tonight. In fact, if you could have a sub today, you would. But it just reflects the words that we are putting out in front. The words of the school hymn, may they forget the channel seeing only him. The school was all abuzz yesterday because there was a supposedly great man on campus. Do you know who it was? Who's on campus? Nick Saban. I say bah humbug. I was in the presence of a great man yesterday. He led our faculty prayer time. He taught his classes the gospel. Sure, football games are fun and worthwhile, but when this world passes away, the record books are going to burn up. As a teacher, you looked down the corridor of life and said, yes, it's eternal souls that I would like to influence for God's kingdom. C.S. Lewis says, "There are no ordinary people. You have never talked to mere mortals. Nations, cultures, arts, civilizations, these are mortal, and their life is to ours as the life of a gnat. But it is immortals who we joke with, work with, marry, snub, and exploit. Immortal horrors or everlasting splendors." Just today, I was at the University of Memphis, and I ran into three graduates, William McGowan, Annie Gorman, and Terry Tees. Terry Tees, in my class of 1988, brought up something she had learned in Senior Bible. That was 30 years ago. But those eternal truths that you taught us will be beyond 30, 50, 100 years. They will stay for all everlasting. If you have sat in Mr. Brink's class, please stand up. If you had a family member who was ever in Mr. Brink's class, please stand up. This is your legacy. These souls reflect conversations around dinner tables and changed hearts and minds. You may sit down. You are a giant among teachers, but why are you such a great teacher? Because you have loved us so well. Thank you, Sandy, for giving us Mr. Brink for such a long time. Thank you, Josh, Noah, Daniel, Lisa, Katie, and the grandkids for giving us Mr. Brink. He has loved us faithfully. He has made us many cups of coffee. He hasn't drunk a single one. In fact, you would probably want this plaque to be by the coffee machine, not on the building. Thank you for caring about the little details, giving us the best deals on textbooks. My students wonder why I copy on two sides of paper. It's because of you. Why do you ask us so many questions? It's not like you don't know the answers. It's because you're demonstrating possibly the most important characteristics of being a phenomenal teacher, the attribute of being incarnational, reflecting Christ. Demonstrating the infinite yet personal aspect of God's character, Psalm 33:22, "Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you." You're always the first one here in the morning. You're always the last one to leave in the afternoon. You have loved us well. And even your decision to establish the Mark Brink tuition grant demonstrates your love for the faculty. I would never presume to speak for God, so this is coming from us. ECS says, "Well, well done, good and faithful servants." Now, if you are a faculty member, past or present, if you could please come on stage. You have not just been teaching faculty, just students. You have been teaching faculty members. I could go through every class you've taught. The souls that you have reached. These faculty have been touched by you. They have been loved by you. Mr. Brink, if you could please come on stage. This is the Mark Brink Auditorium. This is the plaque that is going to be out front, made by Mr. Clay Enoch, graduate sometime. On behalf of all of us, we say thank you. Well done, good and faithful servant.
I'd rather be in my classroom. I have students right now that are working probably on an assignment that's due by 11:59. Well, it's true, this has been probably the hardest event that I've had in 46 years. I'm not sure why Paul hasn't been sleeping, but I haven't been sleeping. But how can you say thank you to people like this? To students that are friends, graduates that are friends, to my family, my wife. Yesterday was our 50th anniversary. When we got married for 4 years, I was in graduate school and studying every night. And then I started teaching, and probably most evenings still bring things home. And she says, when are you going to get out of graduate school? And basically, I'm a slow learner. So there are plenty of thanks, even for all of the details of tonight. I don't know all of those details, and I'm not going to mention names because I miss them. But we have, even though we do not, I don't like things like this, it's because the Lord is good to the school that we have occasions like this. And it's His mercy that He has extended to us, His mercy. I'm thankful that the gospel reaches older brothers, self-righteous, arrogant people like myself. The gospel does that. So I'm thankful for a Savior who's great, His great love and compassion. Thankful for God's providence. I went to college for 4 years and graduated 4 years not to be a teacher. And sure enough, what happened? I'm a teacher. And that's the Lord's goodness. That's His plan. Thankfully, He is the one that knows the beginning from the end, or the end from the beginning. And so I give Him praise, and I give Him thanks for the blessing that I have received from the people I've worked with, and from my students, from graduates, from my family. I give Him praise for that. And when we ended the year last year, and it was announced that there was going to be a scholarship in my honor, and as we talked about that this fall, I asked if maybe that could be adjusted and keep the money sort of within the school. And they agreed, and so that's why we have instituted a scholarship or a grant that will go to faculty members who have needs for tuition for their own children. I have had the privilege of teaching my three sons. It would be unthinkable if they had gone to another school. And it's a pressure for our faculty, not every faculty member, but many of them, as they look at their children, and the school can only give so much money. And so this tuition grant, hopefully, what they qualify for, and what they need, and yet the school can't provide it, that's what we would hope, is that we would have sufficient funds to help faculty members that they could send their own children to the same school where they're committing their lives to. And so that's what that is, and we're hoping that we've got an art show here tonight, and we want to raise money for the annual fund. We don't want to take money away from that, but also this is probably the first time that people can give gifts that will directly impact faculty paying for their children to attend the school where they're teaching. So we would ask that the Lord might be pleased to bless that. And I'm so thankful that today we're ending this time with the school hymn. That hymn is worth memorizing. Our seniors memorize it. I heard the fifth graders, I think they memorize it too. If you go to the fifth grade graduation, they sing May in the Mind of Christ. It's a prayer. It fits an educational school so well. May His beauty rest upon me as I seek the lost to win, and may they forget the channel. see only Him. That's what we hope. So thank you very much.
I have to tell one more story, because this has been a heavy moment, so I'm going to tell you a funny story. Early on in my job here, my old Volvo died in the parking lot. And I was parked him in the parking spot that was adjusted for him. Mr. Brink's laughing because he knows what I'm about to say. And he's always the first one here. It's known. He is always the first one here. So he saw my car in the parking lot and didn't know that I was driving another car, and he walked up to me in the hall. He said, you probably don't need to sleep here. And I said, thank you for caring. That means the world to me that you would care that much to think that. So we are going to stand and sing together, and then I would ask you to remain standing as we are going to escort Mr. Brink and his family out so that he can get to where he needs to be so that we can greet him properly. So if faculty and staff, y'all want to stay on stage, that would be great. So I would not be the one near the mic singing. That would be very, very helpful. But we're going to sing together and then remain standing so that they can escort the Brink family out. Extend an invitation. Not only am I excited for who ECS is, but I am even more excited about where we are going. And I want to extend a personal invitation to everybody in this room. Please come on campus. I would personally love to take you around and show you what is happening, because God is moving, and I could not be more excited about where this school is headed. So I want you to come, and I want you to see. And it's not anything to do with me, and these people are fabulous, let me tell you, but it doesn't have anything to do with them either. This is a place about living for the glory of God, and I don't want to be any other place. And so I'm really, really excited to be here. I'm humbled to serve alongside all of these people, and I would love to have you back on campus as much as possible. Mr. Brink and his family are going to be in the Legacy Center lobby, so you can go and greet them. And obviously, we have an art show going on this evening with a lot of fabulous artwork that we would love for you to purchase that would go to the annual fund, but more importantly, to the grant that Mr. Brink described perfectly about helping our teachers, faculty, and staff allow their kids to go to a place like ECS. Have a great night. We'll see you at the Legacy Center.